adventure, sports, outdoors. With host Harry Canterbury.
There I was, back in the wild again. And I felt right at home, where I belong. I had that feeling coming over me again, just like it happened so many times before.
Hi, Harry Canterbury with another edition of Adventure Sports Outdoors. I'm standing in front of a plaque that commemorates the Civil War training camp that was here from August of 62 through November. A number of regiments were raised. We're also going to go down to the G.A.R. Hall. That stands for the Grand Army of the Republic, a building built in 1910 for members of the Civil War that served in this area. At the end of the war, there were 622 deaths from Peoria County, and it was quite a sacrifice for these men, young men, who died to keep the Union together.
Adventure Sports Outdoors is brought to you in part by Corsall Lumber, manufacturers of quality hardwood products, buyers of standing timber in Smithfield. Central Pool Supply, everything from pools to pool tables and much more in Peoria on West Pioneer Parkway. Kelleher's Irish Pub and Eatery, located on Peoria's riverfront, open 11 a.m. daily. Eastport Marina, one of the only marinas in its class between Chicago and St. Louis, on Mariner's Way in East Peoria. Goodwill of Central Illinois, free employment and veteran and youth services made possible because you donate. Lori Feld of Allstate Insurance, conveniently located in Peoria, East Peoria, and Springfield. And by Statewide Fingerprinting, specializing in concealed carry and FOID cards, 400 North 8th Street in Pekin. Our thanks to all of these sponsors.
Hi, Harry Canterbury with another edition of Adventure Sports Outdoors. We're at a very special place in our city of Peoria, Illinois, a building that has survived for a long time, and we almost lost it. I'm here with Joe Hutchinson, and he's involved here at the GAR. The GAR stands for the Grand Army of the Republic, and it was one of the most politically powerful entities during the turn of the century. In fact, many presidents' elections were decided by the Grand Army of the Republic. Joe, can you give us a brief history of this building? And I know all the numbers, but you're the expert. Can you tell us when it was built, why it was built, who it's named after, and things like that?
I certainly can do that. Harry, you're definitely right. The Grand Army of the Republic was formed as an entity for Civil War veterans that were returning home because, you know, war is hell, as they might say. So they needed to have somebody to meet and commiserate with. They called themselves comrades. The Peoria Post was named after Colonel John C. Briner. He trained troops here at Peoria. The first post was originally on Adams Street, a couple blocks away from here. It was a third floor rented walk-up. They met there from October 1879 until sometime in 1908, when John Briner's son, Byron Cloyd Briner, also a veteran, decided that they were going to try to build their own hall. They were tired of paying rent. They were tired of walking up three flights of stairs. So they commenced raising funds.
What did the building cost to build at that time in those days, dollars?
Well, at the time, the building originally cost about $22,600 complete. That's the lot and the building. The lot itself was a little over $4,000. The rest of it was the cost of the building. And they first went to their membership to raise funds, then they opened it to the general public. They had little children sitting in their nickels. They formed what they called the Brass Button Brigade. You know, when children raise so much money, they got a little brass button to commemorate the fact that they were a part of it. And as I said, they first went to the post members. And one of the post members' name was Captain Joseph B. Greenhut. He was originally from Chicago, came to Peoria after the Civil War, but that's a whole story for another day, because
that's a long story.
But at the time that the building was being considered, he was already in New York, but he had family here and he came back regularly. We discovered that his old post comrades wanted to build a building. He said, "Oh, would you like some donations?" And of course they agreed, "Yes, we'd love to have you donate." So he donated and donated regularly and donated a lot. This building, like I said, cost $22,800, and he provided over $16,000 of that.
Quite a history here for many, many years, and of course, you're born, you die eventually, and these guys got old, and many of them were in their, they died in their 70s, a lot of them died in their 60s because medical technology wasn't what it was today. Some of them got to be very old, but by around the 1920s, what was it like here at the G.A.R. Hall?
Well, if you remember, when most of these men enlisted, the average age was about 25, like it is today. Your average soldier enlisting, around their early 20s,
mid-20s. You had them 16, too.
Exactly. Yeah. So by 1910, most of the membership of the post was in their 60s and 70s. So let's jump ahead a couple decades, to 1926. There was only about a dozen or so post members able to come regularly to meetings. So they knew their time was numbered, but they wanted this hall to last. So in 1926, they turned the hall over to what's known as the Allied Orders. That's the auxiliary groups that helped the Grand Army Republic. That's the ladies groups, ladies of the Grand Army Republic, the Briner Women's Relief Corps, the Sons of Union Vets. So they took over the hall and continued to operate the hall. They rented it for other fraternal groups to use, church groups use it for services, all the way up into the 1960s. The last post member was William Livingston, and he actually passed away on May 30th, 1945, at age 97. So he's the last member of the post and the last member of the G.A.R. in Peoria County.
Great-grandsons, great-great-grandsons of veterans, how do they go about becoming a member of this old fraternity?
Well, exactly. The Grand Army was set up to end when the last Civil War veteran died. So we as descendants were sons of Union veterans. We were chartered by Congress in the 1880s to continue on the legacy of the Grand Army. It's a national organization. They have a website, SUVCW.org. You can go to their website, and on their website they have a link you can click on for downloading the membership forms.
Got a really neat guy here, Bill Rice from Peoria, Illinois, a big history buff, and his wife's involved with the facility out here on Knoxville.
Wheels of Time.
And so you guys love history, your wife, and you are just crazy about it, like all of us here at this little deal. But you're holding something special. The 47th Illinois, of course, was from Peoria.
Yeah.
And this gun was a relative of yours. Can you tell us a little bit about how you got the gun?
Well, this gun was used by my great-great-grandfather, George Williams. He enlisted in the 47th in 1861. And was discharged in 1866. I don't know much about his history, but his wife was my great-great-grandmother, and she wrote her life history. But this is supposed to have been his musket that he carried in the war. Now, this musket was a smoothbore, and it's about 72 caliber, about 3/4 of an inch diameter, and it was built in 1830 in the Sarn, which is an area in what was then Prussia and is now in Germany. It was a manufacturing area. And at the time it was built, it was a flintlock. And then it was about after 1840, they converted it to a percussion. So this hammer replaced the hammer that was on a flintlock, and it has a nipple here, and it was fired that way. Of course, it's a muzzle loader, And we believe that it must have been refinished sometime, but I have no proof of that. It was probably done before I was born.
I'm here with a guy that is a great contributor to this grand old building. Glenn Zipp lives here in Peoria, and he belongs to some organizations that look after what very little we have left here, and they work very hard to preserve a little bit of what's left here in Peoria. When I moved here in the 60s from Pekin, a lot of those buildings were still here. Everything from the Board of Trade building, the public library, the courthouse, it goes on and on. All the theaters are gone that I grew up, the Palace and the Rialto. But Glenn is working hard to preserve for future generations and for the people here now what little bit is left. Can you tell us about your affiliation with the hall?
Surely. Yeah, I'm a board member of the Central Illinois Landmarks Foundation, a not-for-profit organization that was formed originally to save this building from being razed. We have a broader mission, and that is to preserve and help people appreciate historic structures in Central Illinois. But the catalyst for the organization to be formed in 1972 was the article that Joe referred to earlier, written by Theo Gene Kenyon.
So this building really is the beginning of your organization?
Absolutely. There was no organization
to preserve
until 1972. And at the time, Theo Gene raised the conscience of the Peoria community that this historic building was going to be destroyed, lost forever. A group of people came together. Eventually, they approached Les Kenyon to come and do an estimate in terms of just what needs to be done, when, and how much is it going to cost. And they embarked upon a fundraising program that lasted until 1979. Les Kenyon became president of the organization in 1975 and continued until his death in 2011. Going back to 1979, there were various companies, including Caterpillar Foundation and the State of Illinois, contributed to approximately $90,000 to restore the building, save the integrity of the building from water damage, and restore the upper part of the building, and install a gas furnace in the building. Yep. So in terms of this building, we use it in the public interest. We do rent it out to private parties, but we have a lot of public programs, cultural programs, music programs,
theater programs.
Right. We had a play on Andersonville, for example, by Cornstalk here at the theater.
A lot of people don't know this, but Mr. Avery, the town Averyville was named after him, and he had a plow company, and he spent his time in Andersonville designing a plow, and he would, you know, ride it, and he would use little pieces of wood and build models and things.
Yeah.
And when he got out, luckily he got transferred out of Andersonville, because Andersonville was 13,200 men died in 13 months. It was it was hell.
Well, look, we have a drawing completed, I believe, in August of 1864. Pardon me. And I think there are about 34,000 prisoners of war, Union prisoners of war, in Andersonville. And you will see that in the hall, and that's one of our real treasures.
Yes, it is. Let's go inside and take a look at this gorgeous building. If you have a relative that was in the Civil War, and you like that type of history and would like to be involved in the Grand Army of the Republic's last standing memorial here in the city of Peoria, you need to contact them. And Joe, give us that contact number again.
Our national organization's website is suvcw.org, and from there you can continue on to find information on the organization, and it filters down to us.
We're standing in the main hall here with Joe, and it's really it looks beautiful. It looks like you got fresh paint and all these great photographs. Of course, we've got General Grant and John A. Logan and Philip Sheridan and my favorite general of all time, Mr. Sherman. And anything else? Well, these photographs have been here for a long time, right?
Not necessarily in these exact locations, but they were in the building for decades. You'll note the leaded glass windows.
I love the leaded glass windows.
Those were actually bought by families wanting to purchase memorials. Back in 1909, this building did not have these leaded glass windows. They were just plain glass. So families were able to purchase a window for $100 to memorialize a loved one. Now, we don't have any record of necessarily who they were memorializing. There is note in the building committee minutes that they were in the process of doing this.
Putting names on there.
But we don't necessarily have the names that go with the windows today.
You know, Peoria, Norm Kelly, a good friend of mine, and a Peoria historian, said there's around 622 men from Peoria County that did not return. There was a lot of people from Peoria County that were in the Civil War.
Oh yes, they're numbered into the thousands.
Do you know
over time.
How many regiments or units? Of course, we probably have to go out to Camp Lyon and Camp Peoria in order to see what those units are, but many.
And there's maybe a dozen or so that trained at one time or another in Peoria until they closed the camps down early in the war, then transferred all the training to either Chicago or Springfield.
Right, to Camp Butler.
Right.
Yeah. You've got a number of items from the Civil War that were brought back by a number of veterans. In fact, there was quite a few at one time, but a lot of those were sold and dispersed many years ago, so you really don't have the whole collection that you did at one time. But you do have some interesting things in the other room. Can we take a look at that?
That is true. The veterans, deposit a lot of their artifacts, weapons, uniforms, that type of thing that were in display cases in this building originally. And as the Allied orders, the auxiliaries, got up in age in the 60s, they started dispersing it. Some of it went to the Historical Society. Some of it went to the Daughters of Union Veterans Museum in Springfield. Some members just took home with it. Some was given away.
Right.
But the Landmark Foundation has been able to reacquire a couple things of real special note. We call them war logs. They are artifacts from battlefields, mostly trees that had shells or cannonballs that hit them, and those sections were cut out. And we have a couple of them on display here in the hall.
Well, let's go take a look at them.
Very good. As I said a moment ago, we don't have very many artifacts, but what we do have, we were able to reacquire. The Landmark Foundation was able to acquire from a private collector two war logs. The large one with the steel shot embedded in it was from Cedar Creek Battle, and the tall one originally had a parrot round stuck in it, and it came from Chattanooga, Tennessee. The rest of what you see in the display is left from a display that we did at the Peoria Riverfront Museum a couple years ago, and they graciously allowed us to keep the graphics.
This is a marble bust of Major General John Logan, sculptured by Fritz Treibel, a Peoria-born person who actually sculptured this in Florence, Italy. And he was 27 at the time. Treibel was born in 1865, so he probably never met John Logan, who was nicknamed Blackjack by his troops because of his dark complexion. He was an Illinoisan, born in Jackson County, Illinois. He served in both houses of Congress from Illinois, and he also ran for vice president with James Blair in 1884. He was involved in a lot of battles, was highly respected, and was very active in the formation and running of the G.A.R. General Logan was one of the few civilian generals who was prominent enough that they put a statue of him on a horse in one of the parks in Washington, D.C. So it was quite an honor.
This picture is one of the proposals that architects submitted when the G.A.R. Hall here was in the process of being designed prior to construction. The room we're in now was the original quartermaster's office for the G.A.R. post here in Peoria. Quartermaster was a person that a Civil War soldier would go to, or his descendants' family, to help get their pension paperwork filled out, and he was also took care of the paperwork of the G.A.R. post. We've restored this room and have created it to be a Civil War library. The shelves on the walls were not originally here. I built these in 2009 to house a collection of Civil War books, not necessarily from that era, but on the topic of the Civil War, and they came from the original stacks from Peoria Public Library.
One of the most striking features of the hall as you walk up to the elevator, if you turn around, is this beautiful stained glass picture window in the foyer. It wasn't there originally, but soon after the building was built, it was installed, and it shows a sun on a landscape, and in the middle of it is a reproduction of the Grand Army of the Republic badge that the members wear. Unfortunately, it was destroyed in a storm in the 1960s, at least that's what the word is. And one of the first projects of the Central Illinois Landmarks Foundation was to have the middle section restored. And we're glad we did, because it's an eye-stopper when you look at it.
Hey, I want to thank you guys for giving us all this information about the beginning of the hall, where you stand with it, and of course about what you do and what you have done to preserve what's left here in Peoria. And it's been fascinating, and I highly recommend to get involved with these two organizations, especially if you have a family member that was a veteran of the Civil War. But also, if you love Peoria and you love history, get with Glenn Zipp, and it's called the
Central Illinois Landmarks
Foundation. Central Illinois Landmark Foundation. Thanks a lot, guys. Really
thanks for having us.
Hi, I'm Dave Barth with your Sportsman's Tip of the Week. Many guys and gals are cowboys at heart, and everybody likes to shoot a cowboy rifle. And today we have a few examples of some of those guns. We're going to start first with trapdoor Springfields. This is an officer's model, and it's a current production. Then we have the rifle version, and then we have the cavalry model, which is just identical just about to what Custer had at the Little Bighorn. And then we jump up into lever action rifles, and these are Uberti, and they're exact copies of Winchester 73s. This is a saddle ring carbine. This is a deluxe rifle. And then Winchester started making them. They're made by Maruku, but they have the Winchester name, octagon barrel, and this is a full-size rifle. And if you want to do some long-range cowboy shooting, here's an example of a Sharps rifle. This is made by Shiloh Sharps. It's a 45-110. Probably the most common caliber in a Sharps these days is 45-70. And this particular rifle is a special order. It's got the shotgun butt plate, high-grade wood, factory-installed peep sight, and a extra heavy barrel. I'm Dave Barth with your Sportsman's Tip of the Week. Good shooting.
We're standing by the statue of Robert Ingersoll, the greatest orator of the 19th century. And Robert Colonel Ingersoll created his own regiment here in Peoria in 1862. And he was quite a man. He was captured, but released by the Confederates because of his wit. He was a very funny guy and a very intelligent man. And they were afraid that he was going to go to Andersonville, where he more than likely would have died. But quite a guy, Robert Ingersoll, another famous Peorian. And here is a monument to mark Camp Lyon, which was used during the Civil War in 1861 and 62. It's on Prospect, right across the street from Glen Oak Park.
It's 5:30 in the morning here at Soldier Hill, Springdale Cemetery, the oldest chartered cemetery in the state of Illinois. 5:30 in the morning, Memorial Day, May 25th, 2020. Special day on Soldier Hill, not because only Memorial Day. Today, May 25th, 2020, is the 150th anniversary of the dedication of Soldier Hill and this monument behind me of the Sentinel. I'm thinking this morning, at this moment, 5:33 in the morning, sunrise, Memorial Day, Soldier Hill. I'm thinking of a poem, and it was written by First Lieutenant Hubert Kripe of Astoria, Illinois. Lieutenant Kripe was a B-24 pilot in Europe, and he was shot down and he was a prisoner of war. From Astoria, Illinois, he died in February of 2018 at 97. To all our fallen comrades whose life was snuffed in the futility of strife, ah, you were so
you
young.
You were so young.
Now your children are unborn
and your songs unsung. Mm-hmm. We who are yet alive salute your valor and commit you to you your final resting place. Did you write that?
I wrote that.
It's very nice.
Yes, it's, but it's good to remember. It's good to remember.
And I'm sure that all these guys would appreciate that.
Yeah. 200 plus Civil War markers here. We're standing among them. And if you come to Springdale Cemetery today, Memorial Day, May 25th, 2020, you'll see on top of each stone, by the way, we didn't place them. Each stone has a penny on top of it. And to those that don't know, the military tradition is this. If you come by a stone such as these and read the name or pay your respects, if you have a penny in your pocket, you place it on top of the tombstone to signify you were there. And if we had a message today from Soldier Hill, 150th anniversary of the dedication of the Sentinel statue and the naming of Soldier Hill, if there were a message in all this, it would be simply this: in memorial. In memorial. So, by the dawn's early light, we are going to have a champagne toast here this morning. And I invite the others to join me. Someone pre-poured this for us. Not only a toast in honor of the Civil War burials that we stand amongst, but also Marine Hill, American Legion Hill, and all of those who have lost their lives here and around the world in defense of the United States of America on Memorial Day. We salute.
Adventure Sports Outdoors is brought to you in part by Corsall Lumber, manufacturers of quality hardwood products, buyers of standing timber in Smithfield. Central Pool Supply, everything from pools to pool tables and much more in Peoria on West Pioneer Parkway. Kelleher's Irish Pub and Eatery, located on Peoria's riverfront, open 11 a.m. daily. Eastport Marina, one of the only marinas in its class between Chicago and St. Louis, on Mariner's Way in East Peoria. Goodwill of Central Illinois. Free employment and veteran and youth services made possible because you donate. Lori Feld of Allstate Insurance, conveniently located in Peoria, East Peoria, and Springfield. And by Statewide Fingerprinting, specializing in concealed carry and FOID cards, 400 North 8th Street in Pekin. Our thanks to all of these sponsors.